लेक्चर नंबर 17 डाइजेशन एब्जॉर्प्शन एंड मेटाबॉलिज्म ऑफ प्रोटीन्स। इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट प्रोटीन डाइजेशन इन मोनोगैस्ट्रिक स्पीशीज एंड फर्मेंटेशन ऑफ नाइट्रोजिनस कंपाउंड इन रूमिनेंट एनिमल्स। प्रोटीन दे आर डिग्रेडेड इन द स्टोमिक फर्स्ट because in mouth there is no proteolytic enzyme present in case of monogastric species or ruminant animals, so that's why there is no digestion of protein in the mouth. However, in the stomach there is a production of gastric juice that contain water, then inactive form of pepsin in the form of pepsinogens, inorganic salts, mucus, hydrochloric acid, and some intrinsic factors which are required for the efficient absorption of vitamin B12. They are all produced or available in the gastric juice. The presence of hydrochloric acid converts the pepsinogen into pepsins. Pepsin is the active form of this proteolytic enzyme. Pepsin causes the hydrolysis of those peptide bonds which are adjacent to aromatic amino acids. Aromatic amino acids are phenylalanine, tryptophan, tyrosine. These are the amino acids which contain a ring structure. These are the aromatic amino acids. So preferably this pepsin attack the peptide bonds which are adjacent to the aromatic amino acids. However, this pepsin have a significant action on linkages that involve glutamic acid and cysteine. Cysteine is a sulfur containing amino acid. Pepsin also has a strong clotting action on the milk. The milk protein casein, it get coagulated due to the presence of pepsin. However, in case of young calves, there is another enzyme that is a renin. It is also known as chymosin. So this enzyme is present in the gastric juice of calf and young piglets. This enzyme resembles pepsin in its activity and it causes clotting of the milk protein. The products of protein digestion in the stomach, they are mainly polypeptides of variable chain length and a few amino acids. So it means the protein which is digested in the stomach, that is not completely hydrolyzed, rather that is available in the form of polypeptides for further hydrolysis in the small intestine. And the chain length of these polypeptides also varied. However, there is also a production of few amino acids. Again, the reference book for this chapter, Protein Digestion, Absorption and Metabolism in Monogastric and Ruminant Animal, is from the McDonald book. So this part you can check from the page 160 of the McDonald book. So in the small intestine, again, there is a production of two type of juices. One that is coming from the pancreas, that is known as pancreatic juice, and the other one is known as gastric juice. How these juices they are produced? So there is a hormone known as cholecystokinin or pancreozymin. It is liberated from the mucosa when peptides and other digestive product they reach the duodenum. This hormone stimulates the secretion into the pancreatic juice of proenzymes and enzymes such as trypsinogen, chymotrypsinogen, procarboxypeptidase A and B, and proelastase. These are the proteolytic enzymes, whereas alpha amylase, that is responsible for the digestion of starch, and lipase for the hydrolysis of lipid or for the breakdown of lipid, lipase, that is also present in the pancreatic juice. Along with these, lecithinase and nucleases are also present in a pancreatic juice. So the pancreas is a gland which lies in the duodenal loop, and it has two secretory functions. The one is that is an endocrine process, which is responsible for the production of insulin, whereas the exocrine process for the production of digestive enzymes. And there is also production of water and electrolytes. So this pancreatic juice is secreted, and that causes hydrolysis of different type of nutrients. But from a protein point of view, the major difference between the activity of pepsin and pancreatic proteases, these enzymes have a pH optima around 7 to 9. Whereas the pepsin is mainly active at a stomach pH that is less than 3. So in the small intestine, the inactive zymogen like trypsinogen is converted to active trypsin by enterokinase. This is an enzyme which is liberated from the duodenal mucosa. Trypsin only acts upon peptide linkages involving the carboxylic group of lysine and arginine. Lysine and arginine both are diamino monocarboxylic acid. So you can say these are the basic amino acids, and trypsin mainly acts upon the peptide linkages involving these basic amino acids, lysine and arginine. Trypsin also converts chymotrypsinogen into the active enzyme chymotrypsin. So this enzyme has a specificity toward peptide bonds involving the carboxylic group of tyrosine, tryptophan, phenylalanine, and leucine. Tyrosine, tryptophan, and phenylalanine all are the aromatic amino acids. So then comes a nucleic acid. They are hydrolyzed by nucleotidases. The nucleic acid DNA and RNA, they are hydrolyzed by the polynucleotidases, deoxyribonucleases and ribonucleic acids respectively. These enzymes catalyze the cleavage of the ester bond between the sugar and phosphoric acid ester, and this ester is present in the these enzymes catalyze the cleavage of the ester bond between the sugar and phosphoric acid in the nucleic acid. You are very well aware that nucleic acids, they are made up of a pentose sugar, phosphoric acid, and a nitrogenous base, purine or pyrimidine. So the deoxyribonuclease and ribonuclease, they basically they cause the cleavage of the bond between sugar and phosphoric acid ester in the nucleic acid. The end product are the components of nucleotide. Then these nucleotides, they are attacked by the nucleosidases. So nucleosidases, they attack the linkage between sugar and the nitrogenous base. So that result in the release of free nitrogenous base, purines and pyrimidines. Finally, the phosphatases, they complete the hydrolysis by separating the H3PO4 or orthophosphoric acid from the ribose and deoxyribose. So the hydrolysis of small peptides to amino acid is brought about by the enzymes associated with the intestinal villi. aminopeptidases that are produced from the intestinal epithelium or intestinal lumen, they act on the peptide bond adjacent to the free amino group of simple peptides. Whereas the dipeptidases, they complete the breakdown of dipeptides to amino acids. So there is no digestion in the large intestine, except there is only fermentation, in case of carbohydrate digestion, because almost the digestion process of different nutrients that is completed in the small intestine, but in the large intestine, in the ceca or colon, there is a microbial population that causes fermentation of the nutrients in the large intestine. So same is for the protein that is not being digested. Rather, if some of the protein that escape digestion in the small intestine that undergo fermentation in the large intestine, in the ceca or in the colon part of the large intestine. There is also a production of procarboxypeptidases. So procarboxypeptidases are converted by trypsin into proteolytic enzymes, carboxypeptidases. So they attack the peptide from the end of the chain, splitting of the terminal amino acid, which has a free alpha carboxylic group. So such enzymes are classified as exopeptidases, as the distinct from the trypsin and chymotrypsin, which attack peptide in the interior of the molecule and which are known as endopeptidases. This is the difference between trypsin and carboxypeptidases. Trypsin is an endopeptidase that attack the peptide in the interior of the molecule, whereas the carboxypeptidases, they attack at the terminal amino acid. So the end product of protein digestion in the lumen of the intestine, they are all free amino acids. And there is also some small quantity of oligopeptides or small peptides. These small peptides, they enter the epithelial cells of the small intestine, where they are hydrolyzed by a specific di or tripeptidase. There are a number of these di and tripeptidases that cause hydrolysis of these small peptides in the epithelial cell of the small intestine. However, some small peptides are absorbed intact and appear in the portal blood. They are absorbed as such without undergoing hydrolysis, without being hydrolyzed, and they appear in the portal blood. The amino acid which pass into the portal blood and then enter into the liver, they are absorbed from the small intestine by an active transport mechanism, which in most cases is sodium dependent. So the majority of the amino acids that absorb through the intestinal lumen and then pass into the portal blood and carry to the liver, they are absorbed through active transport mechanism. And this mechanism in most of the cases is sodium dependent, that is a sodium potassium ATPase pump. In case of glycine, proline, and lysine, the sodium molecule is unnecessary. For the absorption of these three amino acids, sodium molecule is not required. There are four systems for amino acid transfers that have been noted in different species. There are four different mechanisms for the transfer of amino acids. One of that mechanism is concerned with the transfer of neutral amino acids. Neutral amino acids mean which contain only one amino group and one carboxylic group. The examples are the aliphatic amino acids. And the second mechanism, transfer dicarboxylic acids like glutamic acid. And one mechanism is responsible for the transfer of basic amino acids like lysine and arginine. These are the basic amino acids. There's aspartic acid and glutamic acid, and there is a separate mechanism. And for lysine and arginine, basic amino acid, there is a separate mechanism. And the fourth system is for the movement of I amino acids. I amino acid is a, like proline is an I amino acid. Rather than having NH2 group, it contains NH group. And that mechanism is also followed by the glycine for its transfer. So these mechanisms are not completely rigid ones. And some of the amino acids, they can be transferred by more than one system. So here you can say this is basically nature relaxation to the body. If one mechanism fails to transfer the amino acid, then amino acid can transfer by using or via another pathway or another system. So you can, that's why different mechanisms they are operating, and amino acids can be transferred through more than one pathway or through more than one system. The absorption of intact protein. Intact protein means the protein which should not be hydrolyzed, or we don't want to get them hydrolyzed in the small intestine. The common example is immunoglobulin, because the objective of immunoglobulin is to produce immunity in the body. So if such type of proteins, they get hydrolyzed, then those proteins will not function for the purpose we are giving to the animal. These immunoglobulins, they are present in the colostrum. So that colostrum, when fed to the newborn animals, so the absorption of these immunoglobulins from the colostrum occurred by pinocytosis. Pinocytosis is also known as cell drinking, so where the molecule is absorbed or transferred as such without being degradation. So immunoglobulins are usually transferred through this pinocytosis process, and that process or that mechanism is mainly active during the early life of the newborn calf. And with the advancement of the age, this mechanism become less functional. So that's why feeding colostrum after 24 or 48 hours will have less ability to produce the immunity in the calf, rather than the colostrum offered during the early life. I mean, just after the birth of the calf, or within 30 minutes or within an hour after the birth of the calf, because at that time the absorption of immunoglobulin is maximum through this pinocytosis process. So that's why we recommend we should feed the ruminant animal, young or newborn calf, as early as possible after its birth, and it should not be later than 1 hour of its birth. So this is all about nitrogen or protein, I say, digestion and absorption in case of monogastric species. Now the next part is ruminant protein or nitrogen metabolism. So in case of ruminant animal, the protein, they are first undergo hydrolysis in the rumen. So that's why there is a different way of utilization of protein in the ruminant. The reason being, in ruminant animals, we usually say it's a nitrogen metabolism rather than a protein metabolism. If you are able to understand this diagram, then you could easily understand the protein utilization or nitrogen utilization in the ruminants. And you can also get an answer why I'm saying it's a nitrogen utilization. So when we talk about the diet of the animal that contain a protein, so usually we say it's a crude protein. Crude protein mean is the way we go for the determination of protein content. Usually we follow the Jeldahl technique, and we determine the nitrogen content of a protein stuff And then we multiply that nitrogen with 6.25, that's an average value or factor, and we get a protein content of a feedstuff. If you say if a stuff contains 6% nitrogen, then we multiply it with 6.25 and we get the value of the crude protein. So here we are determining the nitrogen content of a stuff, and that nitrogen, we are not sure from where this nitrogen is coming. Either that nitrogen is coming from the amino acid, or it might be coming from the nitrogenous salts, like it might be urea. Urea also contains NH group, and ammonium salt, ammonium sulfate, ammonium chloride, all that contain nitrogen. Similarly, biuret is a product that also contains nitrogen. So when we do analysis, we get nitrogen content, and we are not sure about the source of the nitrogen. If that nitrogen is coming from amino acid, then that protein is known as true protein. And if the nitrogen is coming from those compounds which are not amino acids, rather they contain nitrogen, like urea or biuret, then we say it's an NPN compound, non-protein nitrogenous compound. So in a ruminant diet, NPN has a great value as compared to the monogastric species. The reason being, ruminant animal has the ability to utilize nitrogen. Even if we are not feeding true protein to the animal, we are not feeding amino acid to the animal, they have the ability to synthesize amino acids from these NPN compounds. So in a ruminant diet, the protein is available, or if we feed urea to the animal, that have both true protein and NPN compound. When we talk about the monogastric diets, NPN compounds are also present. In a natural diet, NPN compounds are also present in a very small amount, but that nitrogen have little nutritive value for the monogastric species, reason being that nitrogen would not be converted into amino acid. So that's why we do not go for feeding urea to the monogastric species or NPN compound to the monogastric species. Ruminant animals, definitely to lower down the feed cost, we use NPN compound rather than using the costly protein stuff, cotton like meal and protein cakes. So the diet is comprised of true protein as well as NPN compound. So when this stuff enter into the rumen, first we talk about the true protein. The true protein, when it enters the ruminal environment, that depend upon the type of the protein, source of the protein, or ruminal environment. But on an average basis, 40% protein escape the ruminal fermentation. So it passes the rumen as such and enter into the small intestine. So the protein which escapes ruminal fermentation is known as bypass protein. It is also known as ruminal undegradable protein. It is also protein, it is also known as a protein that escapes a microbial digestion, or escape protein. You can name as you like, but as a summary, this is the protein which is not degraded or fermented in the rumen environment, and it reaches the small intestine as such. So when we are going to formulate a ruminant animal diet, we always take care of a protein source that have some bypass value. The reason being, this protein, if it is of high quality, when it is degraded in the rumen, so that result in the production of only ammonia and keto acids. Here I will explain. 40% escapes, and the rest of the protein, that is 60%, it is degraded in the rumen. So due to microbial fermentation, there is a production of amino acids, and that are utilized, and that are not available to the animal, they are further hydrolyzed. The amino group that is removed from the amino acid, that result in the production of ammonia. So due to the deamination of amino acid, deamination means the removal of the ammonia group, there is a production of keto acid. So as a result of protein degradation in the rumen or microbial fermentation of protein, there is a production of keto acid and ammonia. So if you are feeding a very high quality protein, like you are feeding meat or milk protein to the animal, that will be converted into ammonia and keto acid. And even if you are feeding a feather meal, a poor quality protein, less digestible protein, that also result in the production of ammonia and keto acid. So it means either you are feeding a good quality protein or a high quality protein, if it get degraded in the rumen, it will always produce keto acids and ammonia. So high quality protein will lose their value when they are in the rumen due to ruminal fermentation. So the protein which is degraded in the rumen is known as ruminal degradable protein. Ruminal degradable protein. And there is a production of ammonia and keto acid. Then what happens? This ammonia and keto acids, they are taken up by the bacteria. The bacteria convert these two stuff into microbial protein when some energy is available there. So this is the point that I have clarified many times during carbohydrate digestion, that we should manage this energy release in the rumen when this ammonia and keto acids are present. Otherwise, what will happen if ammonia is there, keto acid is there, but energy is not available, then bacteria would not be able to synthesize microbial protein. So this stuff will be lost. Or in other case, if there is a high rate of production of energy, then energy would be available, but bacteria would not be able to manage that energy, or they cannot get maximum benefit out of that energy. So ultimately, we can lose this energy. We can lose this energy without utilization. This energy can also come from this fat and protein. So in essence, the energy and protein degradation should be complemented so that this the release of ammonia and the production of energy will be at the same time or at the same rate, so that microbial population would be able to utilize these stuff and convert that stuff into microbial protein. So microbial protein is of good biological value, and then it pass on to the small intestine for further degradation or digestion. So again, would like to mention that if there is a high quality protein, then again there is a production of microbial protein. If it is a poor quality protein, then again there is a production of microbial protein. So that's why we add these NPN compounds in the diet of the ruminant animal, so that we get ammonia, and that ammonia will be converted into the microbial protein. Or we prefer to use poor quality protein in large amount as compared to high quality protein in the diet of the ruminant animal. And when we talk about the high quality protein, we should go for those proteins which can escape the ruminant fermentation, so that we can save some money in terms of feed cost. So this is what the philosophy of this protein and nitrogen utilization in the ruminant. So you can also conclude it in a way that ruminant animals have the ability to convert good quality protein into poor quality protein, or a poor quality protein into a good quality protein through this ruminal fermentation. Then I will come to the point of ammonia production. So NPN compound, they are totally converted into ammonia, and that ammonia is utilized. So now, if the rate of production of ammonia is very high, then what will happen? The ammonia will absorb through the ruminal wall. So that is known as overflow of ammonia. It will absorb through the ruminal wall and then carry to the liver. So within the liver, this ammonia is converted into urea, and then it is excreted in the urine in the form of this urea. Again, if there is some deficiency of nitrogen, there is a recycling process provided in the ruminant animals. Again, the nature is kind enough. Nitrogen deficiency can even be met through this recycling process. Then this ammonia, rather than going into the urine, it some quantity or some amount is then recycled, and that urea is then passed into the saliva, and through saliva then it enters into the rumen to provide the ammonia. So you can say this is a natural safeguard mechanism to carry on the bacterial activity to provide the nitrogen source, so that bacterial community will not suffer and their propagation and their fermentation process continues. But if there is an excess production of ammonia, then it will definitely go to the liver and to the kidney, or might be recycled. But if liver could not be able to handle that ammonia, then what will happen? The excess ammonia will accumulate in the blood. So the higher level of ammonia will lead to the death of the animal due to urea toxicity, or you can also say it's a nitrogen toxicity. So this urea toxicity leads towards a death of the animal in a very short time if we are feeding a NPN compound to the animal and they are still in fermentation process, because the ammonia production will be at a very high rate, and that causes this higher amount of ammonia in the blood, and ultimately the animal will suffer from urea toxicity and it will lead towards the death of the animal. So we should be careful when we are feeding urea to the animal or NPN compound to the animal, to safeguard animal from urea toxicity by feeding highly fermentable energy source so that it can be utilized. The second precaution at that time is to keep in mind the limits of urea supplementation and slowly release of that ammonia in the rumen through proper mixing of that urea into the complete diet of the animal.